time for round three, and fortuitously, we have won the die roll. Sorry, one of my teammates, Kate Scroat, is always bugging me, even though he knows I'm recording. I'll talk to him later. So round three, we've won the die roll. We're 2-0. Let's try and keep that going. This hand is fantastic, I won't lie. We're going to basically be able to curve out Sacred Foundry into Mountain Ash Zealot with two Magma Jets backing up, and then two Temples backing that up. So we're going to be able to find heaps of gas. The hand is good against control. It's good against aggro because we have removal and pressure, so we can play a bit of a tempo role. This is just sort of like the hand. This is like a very, very, very good hand by this deck's standards. So easy, easy keep. One thing to note is I've said I want to go Sacred Foundry Mountain. The reason for that is we don't have a 3-drop. Now, if I rip a Chandra's Phoenix off the top, that's unfortunate. But I can live with that because I only have 4 of them in my deck, and they're my only 3-drops. The longer you can hold your Scry effects, the more powerful you are. Like scrying on turn 1 against an opponent, I have no idea what he's playing, is just, you know, a bit crazy. I wouldn't know. Like, if I had a shock on top, either shock is either really good in some matchups or really bad, and I wouldn't know what to do. So the longer I can wait, the better, really. With Scry, you always just want to wait longer. So have him Scry land on turn 3, turn 4. Ooh, this looks like it could be the Conley Woods Dredge deck. So we're gonna beat that up. Turn 2 Carrier Tid would be unfortunate for our Ash Zealot, but hopefully we will have a really good target for our Searing Blood. The other thing to understand is that sometimes when you have as much like a scry heavy hand like this, you actually want to hold land drops if you've magma jetted and you already know what the top card of your deck is, because you'd just be wasting the scry. And if you don't need the scry, if you don't need to play the land to curve out next turn, there's actually an advantage in holding the scry, so you get a fresh look later. That doesn't always come up. Sometimes you're not able to do that, but getting the most out of every card is a really big part of playing this deck optimally. Not Carrier Tid or Glade Cover Scout. I don't like where this is going. This is never good for us. Hexproof decks are kind of our nightmare. So if he has like untapped white next turn, we're probably in really bad shape if he's able to slam an Unflinching Courage on this. So we now know that our scry targets are going to be Skullcracks, just to counter any life gain. But we and then just burning him out with whatever else we can do. So at least we sort of know what we're doing. If you can't tell, my voice has changed from like relatively confident to just completely terrified. Glade Cover Hexproof is easily this deck's worst matchup. I'm better than 50% in every other matchup, but I'm 1 win and 5 losses against Hexproof in the 8-man that I posted. It'll be about 2 weeks ago by the time this video comes out. I got absolutely crushed in the finals by Hexproof. It's not fun. I know it's a fine deck, but come on, guys. Give me a break. I'm trying to play Burn. You're playing Hexproof creatures. It's not fun for me. I'm going to bottom this. Searing Blood's a wonderful card against creature decks, but it seems that his deck is, of the Hexproof variety, so I just don't want that. Can't target. We really, 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 really want to fade Unflinching Courage here. If he plays anything else, I'll be super happy. And we're going to be Magma Jet. Oh, so no Unflinching Courage. I am super happy. Now, he might have Witchstalker, which is going to shut us down, but we're going to be able to end of turn Magma Jet and hopefully find more action. We're sort of making use of all those scry effects to just dig through our deck as quickly as possible. We have 8 points of burn that goes to the face, so we're halfway to a kill. Hopefully Ash Zealot can continue to get in. If we can, again, just... Oh, it's nothing? So, this is quite bizarre. Alright, I don't know what we're facing. I assumed it was some sort of like Hexproof aggro deck, but I might just be completely wrong. Chandra's Phoenix Magma Jet. I'm going to keep the Phoenix, because it just accelerates our clock. The Magma Jet is more of what we already have. We already have two scry effects in hand, so I don't want that, and I'd rather be drawing more powerful burn spells. We don't know what's on top of our deck now, so I can just play the Temple of Triumph and we can go for it. I don't know what combat trick our opponent is representing, so if I'm running Ash Zealot into something that gets it killed, I guess it's better out of his hand. I just... another Chandra's Phoenix, I will... That's really interesting. I don't know what he's playing, so I can't make the best decision here. This now tells me that the correct line is actually to attack with Ash Zealot first, because if our opponent is able to kill it, then I would want Phoenix, and we'd be able to know to keep the Phoenix, whereas if our opponent doesn't kill it, I don't really want it. I kind of want more burn or Skullcrack just to hedge against life gain. I'm going to keep it, because I think applying more pressure is good, and our opponent's mana base doesn't look like it's going to be the sort of deck that can cast Bioblight. But this is sort of, I guess, with Scrylands, an example of you want to hold them, you know, I said as long as possible, and sometimes that means in a turn not playing them pre-combat. So lesson there as well. So maybe I'm not playing the best at 2 in the morning, but we're definitely learning a lot of lessons. I'm hoping I just see removal spell here, but we'll see. This protects us against, and he's just taking it, it seems to be. Yep, damage on the stack, okay. Again, we just don't want to see untap Unflinching Courage. I don't know if that's what his deck does. I don't have any idea what this deck does, but if it's an Unflinching Courage deck, we're coming in for 6 next turn. So, with potentially Shock and then Magma Jet and another 6 the turn after, so unless he's able to, like, really go off, we can actually race. We're getting to the point where we can race Unflinching Courage. Alright, so our opponent's conceding. We saw 2 land and Glade Cover Scout in that game, so I have absolutely no idea what he's on. It could be... I green-black makes me think the Conley Woods Dredge deck, but that deck has no reason to play Glade Cover Scout, so... I have to assume he has life gain in the board. Even if he's not junk colors in green black, they have Gift of Ortserver. So I assume that's in his board. I just wish I'd seen more cards. I really don't know what I want. I'm gonna cut Searing Blood because it only I assume he's creature base. I can't hit it. I guess. Yeah. I'll cut the 2 Chain to the Rocks, because, again, I assume I just can't hit anything. I might be completely mis-sideboarding here. I don't know. Chain to the Rocks is also quite weak to Abrupt Decay, which I assume he has access to. I'm going to bring in Fire Drinker Seder, because I just want to... Against these sort of decks, I just want to be as aggressive as possible. And with that in mind, I'm also going to bring in Vyashino First Blade, because when you want to beat down, he's definitely the man that you call. So that looks a lot more aggressive, and just to lower our curve a little bit, I'm going to cut a Wall of this Helix again, just to be more aggressive. So we've sort of become more of a creature-based aggro deck. Hopefully that lines up well against what he's doing, and certainly if he stumbles again, it'll line up quite well. But I don't really know what we're facing, so we're all going to find out. So see you in game 2.